Hello and welcome to Top 10 Tuesday over on Facebook. You can watch Top 10 Tuesday over on YouTube, just the music stream, by going to youtube.com/AussieFloyd/live. But I'm here with Jason Sawford, our wonderful keyboard player and founder member of the band. Hello, Jay. How are you doing?
I'm pretty good, thanks.
And Chris.
Hello again.
Wonderful singer, a regular on the show. Please ask us questions, particularly any keyboard-related questions, seeing as we have Jason here. anything you want to know about keyboard rigs? We did a couple of weeks in a row where we talked about guitar rigs, and that was all very interesting. I should say hello to Conleith, is that right? Sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrong. Jennifer, Christine, Mike, hello to you. Philips von David, hello to you. Francois, hello. Kevin Sandover, Wolfgang, Jenna, Christine, Maria, and Michael. So there's a few hellos there. So what's everyone been up to? How have you been, Jay? Haven't had you on here for a while.
Yeah, well, you know, sitting at home doing home stuff, I guess. Reading lots of books, as you can see. And, not been going out much, but we'll have to do that very soon.
We will be doing that very soon. What about you, Chris? What's...
I've been enjoying the weather today. It's been, we just discussed earlier, didn't we, Jay, that it's really in the UK at the minute. I don't know where people are listening to it from, but weather's fantastic. It's been really nice. That's like the last go of summer before it chucks it down for 3 months.
That's right. I think it's just a bit of a rainstorm.
When we're on tour.
The next couple of days. Yeah.
So we got our first keyboard related question here. It says, Jason, do you use Nord?
Oh, yes. Yes, I'm quite a fan of Nord keyboards. I use two Nords on stage, and I've got a private Nord digital, sort of the Nord Grand at home, which is, I think, it's a wonderful keyboard. I'm quite a fan of the Nord. So, yes, definitely.
Yeah.
You've used them for a long time, Jay?
I've used my Nord Stage for quite a long time now. I recently got a little, smaller one. I can't remember the name of it now. The Nord Grand is the one I only bought out last year because it's only just come out. It's a fabulous sort of piano type one. They've got lots of great classic sounds on. They're a very good keyboard to use.
Yeah. Excellent.
So let's go through the rest of the stuff. So as well as your two Nords in your live rig, I mean, with your main Nord that you use, what sounds does that do? I'm assuming it does piano. Well, I know it does piano.
It's a kind of, it does piano, organs, Fafisa type things. It does a synth unit. I use it as a controller keyboard to change the banks and all the other keyboards. And I've got other keyboards that, I operate from there to get the whole kind of the sound from it. But it's a very versatile keyboard. I use it a lot.
And then the little Nord, what does that do? Is that more?
It's just a little supplement keyboard. It replaced another keyboard I had. I had like a Roland keyboard. The Roland sort of started to get a bit, started to die off a bit. So I got a new one, and I want something kind of small and lightweight that I can do the extra odd sounds that I need to create a palette of everything available.
And then you've also got your Hammond, which is actually now a Hammond. It's not, you used to use a Roland Hammond.
I've used several things over the years. I did have a Hammond X5 for a while, really heavy thing. I've still got it here at home. Doesn't work anymore. I might use it as a restoration retirement project, But... But yeah, I've used like the Roland ones. I've used a VK7, a VK88, a VK, I've used several of the Roland emulations one, but I recently started using the Hammond SK2, which I think is a very nice keyboard. And I might use that in conjunction possibly with some virtual technology, but the one I use is now actually a proper Hammond. Well, it's a Hammond Suzuki, really. It's not like the original Hammond, but... But lugging a C3 around is not, it's a bit impractical, but this is really good. I really like it. I'm very happy with it.
And we run that Hammond out into your computer. We have a Mac in your rig that's running main stage that has some software on it. I can't remember exactly what software that basically makes it sound like an old Valve Leslie or is meant to. And that kind
that's right, yes, some effects and things like that. So just, you know, there's all this technology available today which you can use. And yes, I do run a lot of things to the Mac now as well. So I've got, you know, I've got the main keyboard, and then I've got this virtual technology as well that I use.
Excellent. So let's say hello to a few other people in here. Hello, Julie. Sorry if I haven't said hello to everyone because it scrolls off the top of the screen. But hello to Julie. Hello to David. Hello, Kevin Hopgood, our manager, one of our management team there in the comments. Hello. Jonathan, Craig, Stephen, Donna, and Mike Barnes. Your dad's here, Chris. Hello to your dad.
Oh, behave myself.
Evening, Dad. Someone, unfortunately, has written Bonnie for PM. They've misspelt Bonnie, but trust me, you don't want Bonnie for anything.
No, Bonnie for private message, that means.
Oh, yeah, you can private message him. Is On the Run difficult to recreate? That's an interesting question. Yeah, it is, isn't it?
Yeah, it can be. It's a challenge to get that one. You have to sort of sequence things and add things over the top, and, you know, you can't exactly use the original Putney synth to do it all. It's kind of a multi-layered thing you have to use.
Yeah, there's a lot of layers going on in that one. We've got Kevin Sandover here says, what keyboard player inspired you or still does? Let's say other than Rick Wright, because obviously Rick Wright's inspired you hugely. What other keyboard or pianists or whatever have inspired you as a player?
Oh, well, you know, I mean, there's the usual classics on John Lord and Rick Wakeman and, you know, other guys. I quite like Thelonious Monk's pianists. John Lewis from Mon Jazz Quartet. So there's some names, you know.
Fantastic. We got Heike says, hi from Germany. Hello, Heike. I'm going to translate this one. You are immortal. Congratulations. And thank you for the excellent, super exceptional music that we will never forget. Thank you. That's translated from French there. So hope that was accurate. Thank you very much. So when are you coming back to Spokane? WA, that's Washington State. Hopefully next year we will have the US tour dates. They're being worked on at the moment. So,
is that where we played at that new casino that was like the paint was still wet? It was that new.
Yeah, I think Spokane was.
We played outside,
didn't
we?
Outdoor gig. Yeah,
yeah. We were there for like 3 days or something. It was that was great.
We've got Stephen Logan here. Says any Ray's Ray. You'll know how to pronounce the name from The Doors, Chris.
Oh, Ray Manzarek.
Ray Manzarek.
Yeah, yeah. Another one I really like.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He did some great stuff. Great keyboard.
We got Mark.
Yeah, in the left-handed bass as well with the...
Yeah, yeah. I was fortunate
that's
to see
a real skill.
A few years ago.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, it's passed away now, but yeah.
Very good. Are Yamaha keyboards any good? We got
I have to admit, I don't really not really use much Yamaha. I do actually have an old vintage Yamaha at home, an old original pre-MIDI Yamaha CS5, which I picked up at a market for about £30, and it's like about, worth a few hundred now, at least. And yeah, that's a sort of one of the classic ones. But I have to admit, I've not really explored Yamaha, except maybe Clavinova, which are good keyboards.
So we got Apollo Sun here saying, what's your absolute favourite keyboard song to play?
Oh, I suppose it'd be something like Trans 69 when I'm doing that one, because that is almost like a little keyboard concerto. Mm. And so it's very involved. Yeah, I like playing Eugene a lot as well.
Oh, yeah.
Eugene is, the Hammond tones in that are absolutely beautiful.
Yeah.
There,
does that when there was a tour where we did that? Did we do that at the same time as we were doing Fat Old Son? And you had that keyboard breaking Fat Old Son, and the Hammond sound on that was just so good. It was so you wouldn't know, you know, if unless you know you're a massive bootleg collector. It was absolutely bang on. It was so
yeah, that was good sound. That was fun to play. I'd really enjoyed doing that one. Yeah, I actually did that on a Roland rather than a...
Was that before you went to... Oh, wow.
Yeah, before I went to, yeah. So it's a, what is it, Roland VK88 or something, which I still got. But I used that one, and then before I got into the new Hammond I'm using now.
Can you remember what you started with when the band started, when you first sort of turned up in the first rehearsal room? What did you have?
Yeah, the first keyboard I had was like a Roland Jupiter 4. Classic keyboard. I bought it for about $400, and then it kept going out of tune. I thought, oh, this is not very good. So I sold it for Steve for about $150, and now they're worth about $3,000 on eBay.
All right.
I wish I kept it. I used to go like a Korg Poly 8.
Hang on, Jason, you're breaking
just
up.
Just in there.
I think.
Say that again, Jason. Right. We missed it. It broke up. So you said you think you also had.
And then it stuck.
Yeah.
I actually have a Hammond X5 with a Will Leslie and a massive heavy thing. You know, it's supposed to be portable keyboard, but, you know, for people to carry the Leslie. And then I think the band at the time saying, you've got to do something about this Leslie. It's too heavy to carry. So I've got a little Roland G4 as a Leslie simulator, which is, you know, I've still got it. Still, I think I bought about £150, and they're still worth more, worth doubling value now on eBay. It's amazing how this equipment just is always still in demand now.
Yeah, it's classed as vintage, even though it's not that old.
I think you know, you've got the 70s stuff, and now, you know, the 90s stuff is becoming collectible as well.
Yeah,
absolutely. Same with guitars as well.
Same with guitar,
guitars that I still see as quite new, you know, guitars from the early 90s. They're kind of vintage now, I suppose. We've got a hello to Mike Penninger. I think I haven't said hello to you yet, so hello, Mike. And, of course, Barry Organ, which is kind of nice because we're talking about organs there, and Barry Organ turns up.
It's like he knew.
Always. Korg G4, Craig Davidson says, and they're all sort of talking about Korg stuff. So the thing about keyboards are is I'm not an aficionado with keyboards, but it seems there's a lot of similarities between different ones, you know, because fundamentally a lot of them are trying to model sort of basic synthesis from the early analog synth. So what's the difference between when you tried to, say, get a synth sound on your Roland? You used to have a Roland synth, didn't you, at the top, and then now you have a Nord there. What's the main differences?
I mean, you know, if you get like a traditional analog synth, it's all these knobs and sliders, and it's this kind of, you know, in the electronic circuits. But with the digital, it's obviously emulated, and you know, it's I don't know. I mean, the Nord though, it does try to kind of emulate a lot of the analog kind of feel. So it is quite similar to you. They've got the knobs and they've got the sliders. Except it's done a different way, and that's one reason I like about it. It's a bit like playing an analog synth, but it's not an analog synth.
When I first joined the band back in 2011, you had a synth which I think broke, which is why you're not using it anymore. But you had a synth that you had sort of above the Hammond bit, and you used to do the Welcome to the Machine solo on it.
And
that had a real squelchy sound to it. It was unbelievable, but I think it broke, and you had to replace
it. I think one of the pots kept sliding and it would go out of tune. I can't remember the name of it now. I've got it in my other room. But it was a pretty good sort of analog style synth, and you know, it was very good for Welcome to the Machine. I also used to use an Insonic SQ80, which I've still got, but once again, it's one of the things that died on the road. Mm. And that used to do, that was one of my original keyboards, as well as at a Korg Wave Station, which I used, yonks ago. So there are a couple other keyboards I've used.
Of all the keyboards you've ever played, which one feels like the most real piano, other than an actual piano?
Well, the one that I've got now, which I've not used on stage, the Nord Grand, is very much like a real piano. The actual keyboard, it was modeled on a Kawai kind of keyboard, and it really does feel like a piano. I mean, the Nord is all right, you know, but I really love what I've got here. But it's heavy, and I like keeping it up. Because if I heard it on the road, I'd never be able to play it. You know?
Yeah. They get chucked around a lot.
But they do, and then, you know, it becomes all this scratched and something. I mean, you know, that is a particularly nice keyboard.
Yeah, there's a couple of couple of things with the Nord that you can get. Some of the more kind of squelchy sounds, like your run like Hell Solo. I think the stuff you've done with that, where you get those sounds out of it. Because is that just that, or do you have any other layers from any other...
Sometimes I've layered it. I mean, some of the sounds in Sheep, I've got a double layering it. But I think with the Run Like Hell, I use the Nord, and it just, you know, it's thick enough to give that kind of sound. I mean, you can get some really good synth sounds out of the Nord, yeah.
Mm. No, that's a particularly good keyboard. I can't get anywhere near as much. I've got a little Korg, I've forgotten what it is, Korg X5 or something. It's a real...
Oh, that little thing.
And yeah. I just use it as a trigger to play into my computer, and the sounds on it are just so retro, you know. There's no... Have you ever had the... What was the classic keyboard back in the day? Was it a Yamaha DX7?
The DX7 was
Yamaha DX7. Yeah.
I know you said you didn't use much Yamaha, but did you ever have that or play on one of those at all?
No, I never did play that one. I keep seeing it on eBay, and I think, should I get one just for the sake of having one? but I never actually played it. I mean, there's also the Kurzweil K2000 that Rick Wright used.
Yes.
Was it another version, which I actually now have. I have a copy of one of them. And they're actually pretty good keyboard too. But they're obviously older now. I forget what I was going to say. But yeah.
No, well, I mean, the thing is, fundamentally with these things, Jay, is these digital units, and you say, well, that's an older one now, because it's software generated, the next one will produce the same sound and better, in theory.
It's just upgraded. Yeah,
it's not like it's they're using a slightly different analog circuit, so this one sounds warmer or whatever, because these things are digital. There's no reason to have an old vintage one to get a particular sound. You should be able to get that exact sound.
I remember when I saw Gilmore on an Island tour when Rick Wright was still with him, and they played Echoes, and he had the Farfisa there, and it was just like a magical, oh my God, he's actually got Farfisa, and he's playing it. It's not just there for show. It was, I would love to own a Farfisa Compact Duo one day when I win the pools or lottery or whatever, just because it's just my favorite, one of my favorite keyboard sounds. When I joined the band with Ricky and we were opening with Astronomy, and you were doing that, fluttery intro. Oh, it's just amazing. That opening bit of that song is one of the highlights of anything that we've done for me. It's just so atmospheric and it's brilliant.
I agree. It's my favourite song to...
Yeah, it is your favourite song. Yeah.
It's my favourite song to play live. I'm just thinking, so then going back to your rig, are all of these various different keyboard outputs, like the Leslie Simulator output and other layered sounds, you've got the two Nords and you've got another synth and a module, all of those end up going to a mixing desk, don't they? Same as Steve's rig, they end up going to a digital mixing desk where you can recall the...
Yeah, that's right, yes. Difference. Yes.
And so explain how that works. You say you kind of change patches on your Nord, but that changes the patches on all the keyboards and on the desk, I assume?
That's right, it's all MIDI'd up and it changes, and I kind of got everything in order, so every time I change the sound on Nord, all the other sounds and all my other keyboards change at the same time. And they're all like patched into the desk, which is a Yamaha 01V desk. That is a piece of Yamaha equipment I use. Excellent desk. and then of course, you know, you've got the outputs to the front house. So it's it's all like through a sub mix.
Yeah, so it's all kind of mixed internally and effectively you're...
That's right,
you're just giving a kind
but
of...
Sometimes the Hammond doesn't go through the desk.
No, the Hammond has its own out, so it's two stereo pairs out to the monitors in the front of the house.
But all the other keyboards do go through the desk.
And you also have a sampler running in main stage for things, you know, like wind noise and stuff like that. You have a main stage.
Yeah, it's all that, you know, it's all like that I've used.
To trigger off sounds, which is good. Hello to Linda Dublin. Linda Dublin is quite famous on here because she's the only person to have beat Chris in the Pink Floyd trivia quiz.
She's the only
person to have beaten Chris. So
beaten the Oracle.
So over on YouTube, youtube.com/AussieFloyd/live, you can catch the Top 10 Tuesday show with the music. Or if you're listening later on the podcast channel or on Facebook or on YouTube, then you can't, but you could go to youtube.com/AussieFloyd and check out one of our Top 10 Tuesday shows or some of our other videos. But at the moment, over there live is playing Thin Ice, Another Brick in the Wall, part one from 2019. It's a bootleg from 2019, the last time we played that pair of songs.
Yeah.
And that's position number 8 this week in the chart. That's what you voted. It's number 8. We've got Stephen Logan here saying, I love Cymbeline's Doctor Strange reference. Is Cymbeline a favourite to play?
Yeah.
You're not.
It's a lovely song. I really like playing it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's got a beautiful Hendrix-y guitar solo in it, the way we do it with like the mixing in the, you know, live version of it. And it's got a really nice Hendrix-y guitar bit. And you're piano all the way through that, aren't you?
It's just piano, yeah. Quite simple, but effective, I think.
Bit of a slapback delay on it as well.
Yeah, that's right.
Lots of... Because that's the thing as well. It's not just getting the keyboard sounds. It's then getting all the effects and stuff like that and trying to get it to be processed as if it was in the studio, you know, so you want...
Well, that's right, you know. That's sort of those dark side sounds, you know, any colour you like, and brain damage eclipse, that kind of the brain damage where they've got the two stereo synth lines. And
yeah, so that's a really good sound to talk about, actually, the brain damage one, because from my memory, it comes from your Nord, and it also comes from another sound module, and then we put auto panners on them, so they pan, but they kind of, as one's pan on one side, the other's on the other side, and they kind of pan across each other.
That's right,
So what's coming out the Nord, and what's coming out the other unit, and what is the other unit?
Well, it's just the actual synth cell has actually got two lines to it, so one synth plays one line, and the other synth plays the other. And then they both run into the desk, and then that's when you do all this kind of auto pan stuff.
The auto pan happens on the desk, doesn't it? That's an effect.
Yes, built
in the desk. So yeah, and what's the unit that's not the Nord? Is it Alesis?
It's an Alesis. Yeah, actually, it's one of my legacy keyboards, but I use it's got some good sounds in it, so I keep it there as a backup, and you know, I do use it for that sound as well.
And your Shine On solo sound, that's another really iconic opening of a gig. You're kind of like the first person to play
on
aren't
stage.
You, if we open with Shine On.
Yeah. I mean, I use a combination of the Alesis and the Nord for some of those solos.
So Linda Dublin says, what's the most difficult keyboard effect to use? I assume what's the most difficult keyboard effect to create, I would assume.
I would say, like we said, the brain damage, that's quite tricky, that's quite involved, and took a bit of while to get that one. I know sometimes getting the delay units right, you know, like for example in Shine On 69, well, that's not that difficult, but you know, I'm just trying to think off the top of my head what would be, but well, that's a couple of examples.
Yeah. I mean, Welcome to the Machine. What do you use for Welcome to the Machine now? Now you don't use that.
I use the Nord. And again, as I said, that's a good keyboard. I've got like two synth sounds on the Nord. We've got a slight delay between each one to get that kind of slight echoey effect.
Yeah.
So
what... on something like that, when you're doing it, how similar is that to something like Run Like Hell? Because I kind of put those keyboard sounds in the same category, like the Run Like Hell solo. And
there is some similarity. I mean, some of the waveform might use it. I mean, I can't remember off the top of my head what waveform I would do. But yeah, there was a degree of similarity. But I think, you know, trying to find the envelope and the wavelength, and you know, it's a similar approach. Like listening to how the structure of the sound evolves over time, and then trying to emulate that. And it's, you know, I've been doing it for a while, so I kind of got an idea how you create it. But I haven't used that keyboard for quite a while. So
that is fair enough. Stephen Logan here says, "How is Great Gig in the Sky to play? Epic track, because that's a big one where you're kind of on your own for quite a while." Great Gig in the Sky.
It's one of those things where, you know, it's very, very exposed. I mean, it's a beautiful piece of music. I remember once doing a gig, and I made a big clanger of a note, you know, and so it is one of those things that I really have to concentrate, because if I make a mistake in it, everyone can find it, and they'll all laugh, you know. So But yeah, other than that, it's, you know, I've been playing it for years and it's good songs.
We've got a question here asking about click tracks. There's certain songs that have bits to clicks and certain songs that don't. It all depends on the song. Some of it is just for syncing with video and lights and stuff like that, but certainly not. It's not like, you know, we hit go and we get a click and that's it for the whole gig. You know, there's a lot of room for movement, which is quite nice. You know, and that's those songs, like you were saying earlier, Jay, like Eugene and Fat Old Son. I mean, there's no clicks on any of that kind of stuff.
And that's right. No,
it's more,
and some of them not even a click track. It's just like a cue.
Yeah. So we all come in together.
There'll be a little shine on, but a little, but it's still quite free. Free fall.
It is.
Jay's, you sort of have to feel it, but it gives us the clue as to when you come in, and then we can sing it up with it.
So Jay Zoom's breaking up there, but he's saying, yeah, there's times where we just get something for timing, just to make sure we're not rushing or something, but then the click track disappears. We might just get like a count in, like something like the beginning of astronomy, you know, just giving us a count.
Yeah, we get that count, don't we? Yeah.
And then it's free. Yeah, so something is thinking about the delay effects. Yeah, I mean that's a good example of where we would need to. But then again, something like Run Like Hell has no click at all, and that's delay all the way through, and we just basically time it off me starting it on guitar, and then Bonnie has that pretty loud ear, and sometimes if I feel it slip out, I'll hit a really hard D on the one of the note, so you can hear the D and the delay repeat, so that Bonnie can kind of pull back, you know. So no, a lot of that stuff is actually pretty much free time, you know. It's you just get used to it after a while, you know. Funnily enough, when I've edited videos and we've had two or three videos over two or three different nights, you know, and I've want to use angles from different nights and merge them together for a video, Bonnie really doesn't go out that much with those songs with the clip. I mean, sometimes I'm stretching a video maybe sort of 99 or 101% of its original length, but I mean, it really isn't. Across the song, he's
bang on, isn't he?
1 and a bit percent out or something, and his timing is actually incredibly good. Things like One of These Days as well, there's you know, no clicks, nothing on that. So it's you know, he's absolutely bang on every night. So, you know, it's very rarely that I praise Bonnie, actually, but there you go.
Yeah.
His timing is impeccable for a drummer.
Plus, he's working with a ginger bass machine as well, isn't he? Who never, you know, never drops a note, never drops a beat. He's not human, that lad.
Ricky's a machine. He really is a machine.
He is a machine.
And his timing is...
I hate to say this, but they bring out the best in each other. On stage.
No, they are a really, really good unit together. You know, we want to get Bonnie on here at some point. We've had a bit of a running joke that he's on his way, but he's not made it. Every week he's not made it. And, you know, one week he was at the vets, another week he was still trying to get up the stairs, but hadn't, you know, couldn't quite get there. And I think today he's stuck on the toilet, you know. So, yeah, any more questions, particularly keyboard-related questions? We've got Linda Dublin saying she loves the Shine On keyboard solo. Yeah, that's particularly good. Mm. So is the sound for your second keyboard solo the same as your opening sound for that, Jay? You know, you play a solo between my two solos.
I do slightly different keyboards, you know, the attack of the opening one is slightly different to the second solo, or even to the Shine On 6-9, which is a similar sound on that kind of smooth horn like sound, and there's like two of those sounds I use, so I do slightly different.
There we go. There's Jason Zoom is breaking up a little bit there, but I think you got the idea of what he was saying there, or at least I hope you did. You're back now, Jay. I can see you. Hello, mate. So,
yeah.
Okay, yeah. Favorite beginner keyboard to get Pink Floyd sounds. If someone had to get a keyboard, one fits all to do some Pink Floyd stuff, what would you suggest? A Nord?
Oh,
try and find a second-hand.
Well, I mean, Nord is good. I use Nord. I recommend them. Whether that's a good beginner keyboard to do Pink Floyd, I mean, that's an interesting question. I've never really thought about it. I think to get all the full gamut of Pink Floyd songs, you might want to use more than one, you know. But Nord is a fairly good choice if you get the bigger one, the proper synth ones. I mean, I'm sure there are Roland things, or I've used Korg keyboards, like a, you know, like Korg Triton type thing. They're all good keyboards, you know.
I personally get a keyboard that is a good feeling keyboard to play and not worry about the sounds on it. And if you're trying to go on the cheap with maximum sounds, then just get a laptop.
Yeah,
I agree. And your sounds are just expandable forever at that point. And then if you get to the point where you need something more serious, you could get a Nord. But, I mean, I do that here. I'm not a keyboard player, and I have, in fact, Emily sold it to me, an old Roland piano, and I've got that Korg X5 that's, you know, got, like, the modulation wheel, so I can do, like, Hammond. And I just use all software instruments, mostly IK multimedia stuff. And it just does everything you need to do. And this Roland, I think, is probably like late 80s, early 90s digital piano. But it, you know, it doesn't really matter what the sound is from it, because I'm using a library in the computer. So, yeah, I'd go down that road if you want to do something cheap. Someone's saying Nord Stage 2. Nord stuff's quite expensive, though.
It is,
I mean, you could get a mother keyboard for USB mother keyboard for like 80 or 90 quid. And then you could even you could get something like Reaper or another bit of software on a, you know, 200 quid laptop and install. There's so many free synths out there that are pretty good. I mean, there's some free pianos that are pretty decent. There's open source libraries, and then you can get bits of software that are not free but are pretty cheap, you know. So it's better than maybe a I mean, Nords are generally, you're not going to get anything decent for under a grand, are you? And the decent ones are a couple of grand. Am I right?
No.
I'm not
professional level, aren't they?
Yeah. You're probably looking at close to $2,000 starting price. So it depends on the keyboard. If you want something big and decent, then you're probably not going to get a nice find under $2,000. But you might find a small.
Yeah.
You can hear me? Yeah. You can get an Electro for maybe. But you're not going to get a big keyboard, and it might be a bit limited, although you can do quite a lot of stuff with it. But as you said, go down the virtual route is a good way of doing it. Maybe get something like a Roland keyboard that's got a good keyboard. You've got a good selection of internal sounds, and then you can expand it with virtual technology. It's probably the best way to go down. I still stick with a lot of traditional technology because it's just how my rig has grown organically over time. But
I mean, you're not going to replace something until you break. You used to have physical hardware samplers, didn't you? And then we replaced that with the Mac, with Mainstage, because they broke. And we're not going to go out and buy a rack mount sampler in this day and age. You're just going to replace.
No. So I mean, increasingly, I use a lot of the virtual technology because it is, you know, there's a lot of advantages, and it's not as heavy, and you know. But yeah, I've got a lot of sort of dead keyboards at home.
Sounds like it, yeah.
Must be, that's years and years of collecting them as well.
Yeah.
Luckily, guitars don't go dead like that. You know, you can.
No.
I suppose that's right. So we've got favorite Sid Barrett era song to play keys on.
Oh, good question.
We're having a little bit of breakup from Jason.
I like to see Emily play. You know, I'm doing astronomy.
See Emily play in astronomy, was that?
Yeah, and I think they're the one. I think we've done Lucifer Sam before, but see Emily play is quite fun to play. Arnold Lane, of course, is fun.
Yeah.
But I'm sure a lot of them are quite fun.
Specific one I want to talk to you about, Jason, dogs. Because that's got a lot of synth work in it, and
yes.
What sounds do you use that? Because you've got all that massive middle section, the stone bit, where you're squelching away on an analog sounding synth. What do you use?
Yeah, I think we haven't done dogs for a long time, so If we do dogs again, I'm going to have to do a lot of work and reprogram stuff, I think. I did used to do another Alesis. And the old Alesis are really good keyboards. But yeah, I'd probably do something different now because, you know, it's been so long since we've actually played that song. And the keyboards I did play on it on probably died, so I had to replace them with that stuff.
Yeah, because you did some of that synth work on Dogs on the same synth that you used Welcome to the Machine in 2011. It was that synth that died, wasn't it?
Yeah. I can't remember the name of it now. Because I don't think it was a particularly well-known...
Oh, he's gone again.
But it was quite a good little synth. I just found it in a... I just found it in some shop and just thought, I'll buy that and try it. It could do everything I wanted to do in that respect.
Yeah, it was quite... I just remember it had like these four knobs on it that really squelched things up. You play with
it. It did, yeah, yeah.
They make some...
And that's what I think. It's one of those knobs that kind of got loose, and when you play it, it just all went out of tune and I couldn't really control it. And I suppose I could try to repair it, but I opted for another keyboard after that.
Right, so last questions, because we're up to number 5 on Top 10 Tuesday, and we're going to be sending everyone on this feed over to YouTube to watch the end of Top 10 Tuesday soon. But we've got, why does the final cut always get forgotten? It's a very good question there from Lara Mackey.
It's a polarizing album, really, isn't it? Some people hate it, some people love it. And I think that we have done Fletcher, certainly since I've been in the band, and I've seen the band do Fletcher. I've not seen the band do any other tracks from that.
But no, we've discussed doing the final cut a few times.
We used to do the Gunner's Dream, and then there was a...
Gunner's Dream, yeah.
Yeah, I really like the album, but there are certain challenges with that as well.
I don't think it's as well known. I think the people that know it love it. I think to a lot of the crowd, much beyond Fletcher Memorial and possibly the final cut, the song. I mean, if we were to go up there and do Southampton Dock or I'm trying to remember what's my Paranoid Eyes. Is that the name of it? That's one of my favorites. If we were to go up there and do Paranoid Eyes or something, I don't know how well it would go down with the majority.
Well, you would have a chunk of now, John. To go to the bar. That's a big rock tune, isn't it, really?
Yeah, I mean, it's probably my least favourite song on the album, to be honest.
Mm.
Nobody even talks about it. It's almost...
Yeah, I have done it. Exist.
No, I think people do talk about it. I mean, we have regularly played Fletcher Memorial Home from it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just it's one of those albums, because Rick Wright wasn't in the band, you know, that kind of gets overlooked a little bit, which is a shame, because it's a wonderful album. Right,
it's on the to-do list.
It is on the to-do list. Right, we've reached the end of this. I think people should go and watch the end of On the Turning Away over on YouTube now, and then we'll see what is positions 4, 3, 2, and 1. It's been lovely chatting about keyboards with you, Jason.
Been a pleasure, yes.
We'll get you back on again sooner rather than later. So thanks everyone for listening. Do you want to say goodbye, Jay?
Yeah, goodbye everyone. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Sorry, you just completely it all cracked up at that. That was
great. So you got a real colder.
Classic goodbye there.
Special effects.
Yeah, that was brilliant.
Special effect goodbye. Well, I think we understood what you said. And what about you, Chris? Do you want to say goodbye?
Yeah. See you later, everybody. Jump over to YouTube and catch the rest of it.
So, thanks everyone. YouTube.com/AussieFloyd/live to catch the end of it. Or if you're not listening to this live, then just go to our YouTube channel, YouTube.com/AussieFloyd, and subscribe and watch some videos. And we'll see you at a gig very soon. Goodbye.